how do these isolating mechanisms develop? And that is still not yet entirely clear, because as even was said in Darwin's own day, why should something be selected not to mate with the other population when they aren't in contact at all? There shouldn't be any selective advantage to have an isolating mechanism in this species against this one if they are not in any contact whatsoever. Well, there are a number of ways to explain this. I will not go into detail, but in the case of two species developing out of a single population, so-called sympatric speciation, which for a long time we had no good instances that it occurred at all, but there seem to be some instances now in freshwater fishes, it is possible that this barrier developed by mate selection, in other words, by sexual selection, but the details are still obscure. But the important point at this stage is to have an open mind to see there is a possibility, and now this must be analyzed. All these were questions that went around among the naturalists who were interested in species and speciation, and at the very same time, the geneticists had no interest in these problems at all. You get to go to the classical writings of R.A. Fisher, of Haldane, of Sewall Wright, of H.J. Muller, even of T.H. Morgan, and they discussed how adaptation was acquired, they discussed what happened within a given gene pool, but they nowhere discussed the problems of the origin of biological diversity. And this, of course, set up a considerable tension in the biological community, because the geneticists were only interested in the happenings in a population, while the naturalists were interested in the business of the biological diversity, the origin of new species, the origin of the development of these species into more different, higher taxa, etc. And there was a third group of biologists interested in evolution, which dealt with still other problems, and those were the paleontologists, who were told that speciation, from Darwin on, that speciation evolution was a gradual process, and yet when they looked at the fossil record, all they found were just discontinuities. New species seemed to originate very suddenly, it suddenly turned up in the fossil record all of a sudden, and so on and so forth. So people were arguing against each other. There were still a lot of Lamarckians, and there seemed to be no way in which these differences of opinions could be resolved and solutions could be found that would bring these various feuding kinds of evolutionists together. And this was the situation right up to about 1935. I know a paper in 1935 where somebody said, after I've looked at the literature, there's no question that there will be no consensus in the foreseeable future. And yet in 1937, a book was published by the Russian geneticist, naturalist, Theodosius Dobzhansky, at that time at Caltech in California, on the basis of lectures he had given, the Jesup lectures he had given at Columbia University. This book, immediately everybody agreed, well, here is the basis for such a consensus.